How's everybody doing? If anybody falls asleep during service, I'm not going to fault you for that. It's one of those mornings. Boy, I don't know. I went to bed early. I got up a little bit later than I normally would, you know, considering the daylight savings time, which is earlier than I normally would, but you know what I mean. Anyway, I still feel like I didn't get enough sleep. Anybody else? Okay, just Bo. Oh. All right, me and Bo. All right, we are in Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2, if you have a Bible with you, grab one. If you don't, from the chair in front of you, follow along. We have, as you probably know, we have 8 people in our family. And what's interesting about our family is that only 2, my oldest and the youngest, share a birth month. So we have 7 months out of the year, we have birthdays. But that also means that 7 months out of the year, we have well child checks, which means we have to go to the doctor quite a bit. And if it wasn't just that, it's my monthly shots that I get, and then doctor's appointments for sniffles or whatever else we have to go to the doctor's office for. So I'm kind of what they know as a frequent flyer at the doctor's office. I'm always there. It seems like I'm always there. At least it seems like almost once a week I'm there at the doctor's office for something or another with a kid or whatever. And it seems like whenever I'm at the doctor's office, it's like a second ministry to me. You know, I'm there and then somebody comes in. And either there's somebody who, you know, I've never met, but they strike up a conversation, or I strike up a conversation with them, and the next thing you know, I'm talking to them about the Lord, maybe inviting them to church, or maybe it's somebody who, you know, goes to our church, and I'm there just kind of minister to them, whatever sickness or illness they're in, you know, and whatever they're going through in their life, or maybe it's somebody who hasn't been to church for a while. And that happens quite frequently. And they're like, oh, Pastor Mike, oh, I guess I should be in church, you know, or a doctor or a nurse or whatever. I get opportunities. And so I kind of go to the doctor's office kind of expecting that, like expecting that I'm going to see somebody, expecting that I'm going to be able to minister to somebody. And sometimes even before I go, knowing that that happens, praying, okay, Lord, use me while I'm there. You know, it's like my second ministry over there. The other day, I was actually there with one of my boys, and it seemed like half the church showed up. I was actually thankful because as I'm sitting there, I'm sitting next to the hand sanitizer, and so I'm shaking everybody's hand. Like, where are you here? Oh, I'm just really sick. Nice to see you, Pastor Mike. You know, pump my lather myself up. Oh man. But in a way, today as we look at our text, we see Jesus at his first appointment, his checkup, his presentation, if you will, that they're going to bring him before the Lord, something that every Jewish family had to do. And so if you're able, will you stand with me? We're going to be looking at Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2, starting in verse 22 is where we left off last time. It says, now when the days of her purification according to the law of Moses were completed, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or 2 young pigeons. And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. So he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child, Jesus, to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed him and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all peoples, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is destined for the fall and rising of many in Israel and for a sign which will be spoken against. Yes, a sword will pierce through your own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. Now there was one, Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age and lived with her husband 7 years from her virginity. And this woman was a widow of about 84 years, who did not depart from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. And coming in that instant, she gave thanks to the Lord and spoke of him to all those who looked for the redemption in Jerusalem. And when they had performed all these things according to the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own city Nazareth, and the child grew and became strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. And Father, we thank you for this section of Scripture, Lord, that we're in today, Lord, as we look at just these amazing things, Lord, that you did through bringing your Son into the world, and just the words that were spoken over him, and the things that we see here in your Word today. I pray, Lord, that you would just help us, Lord, to see these things for what your Spirit would be speaking to us. And Lord, that you would make application in our hearts, Lord, as we just seek to know you more through your word. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Now, chapter one, we remember that Mary has been through quite a lot. And I'm sure as she goes into this, she's trying to process all of these things for herself. She's trying to process this angelic visit that told her that she was going to be the mother of the Son of God. She was trying to process probably this the word spoken by Elizabeth, her cousin, who said that she was the mother of her Lord. She's trying to process the dream that Joseph had, that he should stay with Mary and not put her away, because that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. Of course, we see that in the book of Matthew, not in Luke. But then, of course, having this bad news of they're going to have to travel in her third trimester, 109 miles down to Bethlehem, and then, you know, just not having any room for this child to be born in the inn, and having to have him outside somewhere, maybe in a stable, and then placing him, wrapping him in rags, and then placing him in a feeding trough. It had to be so confusing, so unbelievable that they would have to go through this. And then, of course, the shepherds coming and proclaiming how they had seen an angel and that God wants peace towards men, that he has goodwill towards men, and that they were told by the angel they'd find the baby wrapped in grave clothes, lying in the manger. And of course, that's what they found. And they rejoiced and they went out and spread it abroad. And it says that Mary pondered all these things in her heart. It had to have been a very, very strange event, a strange set of events in Mary's life. And yet this child, the shepherds would tell her, was the Savior, that he was Christ, the Messiah, the Lord. And that had to be kind of an interesting thing as we see Mary and Joseph kind of processing all of this, and then 8 days later taking the baby, having him circumcised, and then naming him Jesus according to the word that the angel had given them. And that's where we find ourselves in verse 22. It says, "Now when the days of her purification according to the law of Moses were completed, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord." So just like we have checkups and milestone appointments, they had the same type of thing in their day, except every male that was born would have to be brought before the Lord. Now, if according to Leviticus chapter 12, if you had a male child, then you were unclean for a period of time. A woman would be unclean for 40 days. It was 8 days until the circumcision, then 33 days after that, then she would be declared clean, and she would come to the temple and offer a sacrifice for her uncleanness. And the same thing if she had a girl, except for whatever reason, I guess because girls are twice as good or something like that, they had to wait 80 days. And so it was a little bit longer, no circumcision, of course, but then 80 days that they'd be unclean, and then they'd bring themselves before the Lord, and they'd offer an offering before the Lord. And this is kind of interesting, because this time they'd offer an offering for the child, but then they'd offer an offering for the mother because of her, it says, flow of blood. But notice what it says. It says, as it is written, verse 23, as is written in the law of the Lord, every male who opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord. And so what this means is that every male child, the first child to open the womb, was considered the Lord's. In fact, kind of almost like a priest would be considered the Lord's. And in a way, this child would be holy to the Lord and able as a firstborn son to belong to the Lord. However, they could redeem the child back by paying 5 shekels, which is about 100 grams of pure silver. They'd bring that offering and they'd buy back that child from the Lord. Now, they didn't have to, I suppose, because you remember the story of Hannah. Remember, Hannah goes before the Lord and she's crying out, she's childless. You know, her rival, Penina, was having children and she wasn't having children and she was upset about it. And so she goes into the temple and she's weeping before the Lord. Eli, of course, accuses her of being drunk. And she says, "I'm not drunk. You know, I'm putting my petition out before the Lord. I just want a child." And she promises the Lord as she's crying there that she would give the child to the Lord. "If you give me a child, take away my reproach, I'll give the baby to you." And of course, Eli tells her, "The Lord's granted your request." So she has the child. She weans him. I mean, she has the child. She circumcises him, she presents him for the Lord, and then she weans him, and then she brings him and drops him off at the temple and probably never redeemed him with 5 shekels. She just gave him to the Lord. And of course, that child was Samuel, which seems crazy to me because you think about Eli was not a very good father. He had 2 sons, Hophni and Phinehas, that were a mess. But she drops off her child to Eli to raise, and Samuel literally grows up in the temple. And by virtue of the fact that he was holy unto the Lord, even though he wasn't of the tribe of Levi or the tribe of Aaron, he could be a priest because he was firstborn. He belonged to the Lord. Kind of an interesting twist there. But this is kind of an interesting biblical principle when we think about that. The firstborn belongs to the Lord. In fact, that really is kind of a theme throughout the Old Testament and the Old Covenant, is that every first, in a sense, belonged to the Lord. I don't know if you've noticed that as you've gone through the Bible, but the firstborn son would belong to the Lord. I believe, and this is my personal interpretation of this, and different people have different ideas about it. You can read the commentaries and they'll tell you all kinds of wild things about what this meant. But I believe that when Cain and Abel brought their offerings, that this is really what happened. That it tells us that Cain brought an offering of his fruits, right? Now, I imagine if Cain were to bring an offering of his fruits, and people will disagree with me on this, but I believe that Cain brought his very best. That he brought the best of the fruits that he could possibly produce. The difference was that Abel brought the firstlings of his flock and of the fat. He brought the first. Cain brought his best, the best work of his hands. Abel brought a first without the promise of a second. And so therefore, without faith, it's impossible to please God. I believe that Abel's offering, it wasn't because he was offering a blood sacrifice versus a grain sacrifice. And we see that throughout the Bible that they can offer both. You can have grain offerings, you can have drink offerings, you can have blood offerings. But what I think Abel did was he gave his first. It was an offering of faith. Cain, on the other hand, just brought the fruits of his produce. And God received Abel's offering and not Cain's, because faith is what is required. That's why it was always the first that belonged to the Lord. You remember when they went in to the promised land? Remember, it was kind of a weird story. They marched around Jericho, and then the walls fell down, and they went in and they conquered the city. But the Lord instructed them, don't take anything from the city. It belongs to the Lord. They weren't to take any of the spoils at all. In fact, when they find the excavations of Jericho, they find that the grain is still in the baskets, that there's all kinds of stuff that they didn't rob the city of all of its stuff. They just left it like it was. And why? Because it belonged to the Lord. After that, they could go and take anything they wanted from the cities they conquered in succession, but they couldn't take anything from the first city because the first belongs to the Lord. And it's the same thing with the tithe. The tithe, the first portion of, first 10% of your income belonged to the Lord. All those things always spoke of the first. It was always the first. And so too it was with the firstborn child. That child belonged to the Lord. And so they bring the child to the temple, mandatory check-in at the temple for their firstborn. And it says, verse 24, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said, in the law of the Lord a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now, this is significant because that's not what it says in the law. If you go back to Leviticus 12, it tells you specifically that you are to bring a lamb for the kid, right, for the child, as a burnt offering, and then a dove or a young pigeon for the blood atonement of the, or for blood sacrifice for the atonement or the cleansing of the woman. And yet it says at the end of that passage, or if a lamb is not available, you couldn't bring a lamb, then you may bring two turtle doves or two young pigeons. So what does that mean? Well, it was an exemption for those who were poor. For those who couldn't afford a lamb, they could instead bring two turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now, that's significant because you think about Mary and Joseph, and you think about what their status was, and this kind of indicates that they were very poor. Now, aside the fact that Joseph couldn't even afford to buy a blanket for the baby, that they had to wrap him in rags and lay him in a manger, he couldn't buy, I guarantee you, if Joseph had enough bankroll, he could have bought some space in the inn. Somebody would have given up their space if Joseph could pay him off. But Joseph didn't have it. He didn't have enough to give for a proper place for the baby. And then they go to the temple and they offer the offering of the poor. Jesus knew what it was like to grow up in poverty. And that's kind of an interesting thought as you think about Jesus as a young child, not really having much, being born under probably the worst circumstances you could possibly imagine, and then having to grow up really knowing what it's like to need. In fact, this would be kind of the way that Jesus lived his entire life. You know, he would even say, foxes have holes and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And so he kind of lived this way throughout his life. You know, we think about what it says in Hebrews, he suffered all things yet without sin. You know, he's tempted in all ways. You know, he's gone through in his earthly life a lot. That, you know, we think about, you know, the situations and the things that we have to go through in life, and we think things are hard. I can't imagine what it would have been like in the first century growing up like this. Verse 25, it says, and behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. So now we see this interesting individual, Simeon. He's an older man. We kind of get the idea that he's older because of some of the things it says here. And it says that he's just, meaning that he lived a clean life. He was innocent in sight of people. That was kind of the idea. He was fair with people. You look up the word, that word just, and it can mean righteous, but it also just means fair and honest. And he was devout. And this word means pious. He was a devout worshiper of God. And he cared about the things of God. Now, why was he like that? Because he lived waiting for the Messiah to come. He lived in anticipation. He lived ready in his heart and in his mind and in his lifestyle. He lived waiting for the moment that the Messiah would come. You know, and it's no different for us. This should be the same way that we should live. You know, I was thinking about it. God promised him his Messiah, and this man believed the Messiah was going to come, and he was filled with the Holy Spirit. How long had people been waiting for Jesus to come, for the Messiah to come? Well, all the way back from the very beginning. Remember when Eve gave birth to her first son? She says, look, I've obtained a man from the Lord. You get the idea from the language that she thought that this baby was the promised seed that God had promised that was going to undo what the serpent had done. He was going to crush the head of the authority that the serpent had brought over them. And then, you know, she has another son, you know, Abel. And then Cain killed Abel. And so she realized there's something wrong. You know, Abel can't be it. Cain can't be it now either. And so then she had another son, Seth, and she called him appointed. He's been appointed to take the place of Abel, who was killed. Obviously, he was the righteous one, and now I have a new son.
And that would go on and on when Abraham was told, I'm going to make your seed great. I'm going through your seed, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. And I'm no doubt Abraham believed when he had Isaac, this has got to be the guy. This has got to be the one who's going to fulfill the promise of the Messiah. But then as time would go on, that seed would just continue. And throughout that whole generation of Abraham's line, they believed the Messiah is going to come any moment. Sound familiar? You know, we think about it and we read Peter, and Peter says, you know, there's going to be scoffers that come in the last days that say, where is the promise of his coming? Because since the beginning of the world, things have remained the same. No, actually, the Messiah actually did come. He came, and he came to the temple that day. He was a baby, and they saw him with their eyes. They experienced him. How long after the promise of the Messiah did the Messiah actually come? 4,000 years. We've only been waiting 2,000 years. We are impatient. Now, I think that we believe that the Messiah is going to come in our day. I think that we believe Jesus is going to return in our day, just like Paul thought he was going to come in his day. You know, you read John, and John talks about the Antichrist is coming. And you can think about this. I mean, Jerusalem's been destroyed. It's 70 AD. 15 years later, 85, you see John writing, and he's saying the Antichrist is coming. It's like it's going to be next week, right? And then he says, and Jesus is coming back. And he says, everyone who has this hope purifies himself even as he is pure. You know, there is a purifying effect to that. But from the very beginning, they've thought that the Messiah was going to return. And you know, you look back in writings, you know, 100 years ago, 500 years ago, 1,000 years ago, and people were saying, we obviously live in the last days. But we have more reason to believe we live in the last days than anybody else, right? Why? Well, because that's the way it's supposed to be. That there's this purifying thing about knowing that Jesus could come at any moment. This is what Paul said to the Thessalonians. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9 through 10, it says, for they themselves declare concerning what manner of entry we had to you. And notice the behavior of the Thessalonians, how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. There's a wrath that's coming. Back in the first century, they knew that. There's a wrath that's coming. And yet we're waiting for Jesus to come from heaven to deliver us from the wrath to come. John, writing after the destruction of Jerusalem, so we can't say it was that. It was after the destruction of Jerusalem in 85 AD that he says that when we looked for Jesus, we purify ourselves. And that's what the church has been doing for all these years. In fact, Jesus would say, speaking through John again in 90 AD, he'd say, watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things. Oh, excuse me, that's the wrong passage. In 90 AD, he said this. He said, remember, in Revelation 3:3, remember therefore how you have received and heard, hold fast and repent. Therefore, if you do not watch, I will come to you as a thief, and you will not know the hour that I come upon you. Jesus also told us, after he talked about the wrath that's going to come, and he described the whole that last seven-year period on the earth in Luke chapter 21. This is how he ends it. He says, watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. And so we have this understanding that Jesus is going to come for his church, that we're going to escape the wrath that's going to come, and we're going to stand before the Son of Man. And everyone who has that hope, John tells us, purifies himself. Why does it purify us? Because if I really believe, like Simeon did in his day, if I really believe that the Messiah could come at any moment, I'm going to be watching and I'm going to be ready. I'm not going to be doing a bunch of stupid stuff. If I really believe that Jesus could come right now, I want to live a pure and a clean life, a just and a pious life, right? Because I don't want to be caught, you know, doing something stupid. Jesus, in fact, warned us. He said that there's going to be those who say that the Lord delays his coming. And he says that the tendency of that is going to lead towards carnality, that they would eat and drink with the drunkards and beat their fellow servants. And yet those who watch and are ready, they're not going to be overtaken like those who are overtaken by a thief. Now, of course, we don't have that same benefit that Simeon had, right? The Lord would not tell you or me that you won't see death until Jesus comes back. Why do we know that? Because he says no one knows the day or the hour. In fact, in Acts chapter 1, he says it's not for you to even know the times or the seasons. And so it's going to come on the earth like a thief. No, there's going to be no indication. There's going to be no warning. There's going to be no signs. It's a signless event. Jesus is going to come back unexpectedly. Unexpectedly. And then when he says quickly, when I come, behold, I come quickly, the idea is not quickly any minute now. The idea is quickly, unexpectedly, to catch people off guard. And anybody who's caught off guard will face, you know, what it says in the book of Revelation, woe to everyone who dwells upon the face of the earth. And yet we have this promise we are going to escape the wrath that is to come. And so we have these same hopes. Simeon had that hope in his day. He saw the fulfillment of 4,000 years of promise come to pass before his very eyes. I have no doubt that we could also see these things come to pass in our day when Jesus comes back for his church and the wrath comes upon the earth. And so this guy, by virtue of the fact that he believed the Messiah could come at any time, it really shaped the way that he lived. And God would bless him for it. Verse 26, and it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And so the Lord spoke to him, let him know that you are not going to die until the Messiah comes. Now, we don't have that promise again. We're not going to get that because we don't know the day or the hour, right? It's patterned after the Galilean wedding feast where the bridegroom could come at any moment unexpectedly. We always expect him to come, but we don't know the day or the hour, the time or the season. And yet here's a guy who did have this promise from the Lord. You are going to know before you die, before your eyes close forever, you're going to see the Lord's Christ. Now, this is what this is what we would call this is a prophetic word of knowledge from the Lord. He's given a prophecy that he's going to see this, but he also has given a word of knowledge, something that he normally wouldn't know, something that he couldn't know. And this is something that the Lord still does today. In fact, my wife and I received a prophetic word of knowledge that we were going to have a child, you know, and I've shared that story before. And then two more ladies spoke that over my wife a month before we actually conceived the baby. And after waiting, you know, 7, 8 years, I guess 8 years by the time the second one came, the Lord fulfilled his promise to us. You know, the Lord still speaks to us. He still does these things to us. So, you know, one interesting thing that happened to me was Pastor Jesse, who's the pastor at Calvary Chapel Homer now, he was my assistant for 8 years. Now, when Jesse first came to Calvary Chapel Emmett, I said some things in a sermon that really offended him. And so it was kind of a bumpy start as we started out. And, you know, it worked out. Long story. I'm not going to tell that story now. But anyway, early on, as I got to know Jesse and Kathy, the Lord spoke to me very clearly and said, this guy's going to be a big part of your ministry, or a big part of the ministry here at Calvary Chapel. And I thought, oh, cool. And so I tried to get him involved in youth group. I tried to get him involved in other things, and it just wasn't sticking. And then he just kind of checked out, and I didn't see him for the better part of a year. And I just waited on the Lord, and then lo and behold, the Lord brought him back, and then the Lord did use him. But I just kind of, I remember thinking to myself, man, I really thought I heard the Lord. I really thought that he was going to be a part of the ministry. And after that, when the Lord tells me something like that, I kind of learned, okay, I'm just going to ride this out because, you know, the Lord, when he speaks things like that, he's going to fulfill them in his own time, right? And so I've waited. I had the Lord tell me something about a family that left the church. He told me they're going to be back. How long did it take for them to come back? About 10 years. But they came back, just like the Lord told me. And so I just kind of learned to be patient on those things, to wait on those things and to wait on the Lord. And he does that. Psalm 25:14 says, the secrets of the Lord is with those who fear him, and he will show them his covenant And the Lord does. He speaks to those who draw close to him. And so it says, verse 27, so he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law. And so it tells us, this is kind of interesting, it tells us that by the Spirit, it's like the Spirit woke him up that morning, or the Spirit prompted him to go to the temple. And so he got himself ready and he went. He was expecting. The Lord was telling him to go. It reminds me of a story of Edwin Orr. Edwin Orr was a revivalist, and he basically was living a life just trusting the Lord. You know, he'd go and speak and just go wherever he felt like the Lord was telling him to go, and just kind of had all these miracles happen. And he published a book about all the things that God did. I think it was called God Can or something like that. And somebody criticized them. They said, well, of course, you know, Mr. Orr, you know, of course the Lord's providing for you. You're in England. You're in Europe. You know, people here are generous, and they're Christians. This is a Christian nation. He said, fine. So he booked himself a train to go to Moscow, a non-Christian nation. And as he was going around, he felt like he saw the Lord provide for him miraculously wherever he went. Well, he ended up in Copenhagen in Denmark. And he was there just kind of wondering. He had a buck left. He had to get off the train because he had no more money. And so he goes out to the city square, and it started to snow. And he was like, I don't know what I'm going to do. And so he took his bag that he had, and he shoved it behind a park bench next to a candy store. And he went out into the open square, and he just prayed. Well, then it occurred to him that he'd heard of a man who lived in Copenhagen whose name was Sorensen. And he was like, oh, there was a guy named Sorensen that a friend of mine told me about. But I think that he's a solid Christian, and he's well-connected with the churches around here. Maybe I can talk to him, and maybe I can get some meetings going or something like that. So he went to the phone book and found out that Sorensen in Copenhagen is like Smith in the United States. There was 4 pages of Sorensen's. And he's like, Lord, help me. I don't even know where to start. And then he remembered, it's like the Lord put it into his memory, the guy's name was Niels Sorensen. He's like, okay. And so he got to the ends, and he looked it up, and there was 5 Niels Sorensen's. And so he looked for the one that looked like the closest, looked at the city map, see if he could find out where it was, and he went, and he knocked on the door. He only had a dollar. He didn't want to make phone calls because he didn't want to use his money. So he went and knocked on the door, and a woman answers the door, and she only speaks Danish. And he's trying to speak to her, and she's trying to speak to him, and she gets frustrated and finally just slams the door in his face. And so as he's walking away, the door flies open, and she says, whatever, in Danish, sir, get back here, or whatever, you know, gets his attention, and he turns around, and she says, you, and she has a book, his book that he just published 3 weeks earlier, and a picture of him on the back, you, and he says, yeah. He goes into the house, and she calls up her husband, who does speak English. And she puts him on the phone with her husband, and the guy says, my wife thought you were a crazy man, you know, at the door. But now she's asking if you want to stay for dinner, and he says, you know, this is amazing. He says, I got your book just last week from a woman who's part of the China Inland Mission. She gave it to me. She says, you have to read this. He says, I read it in a week, and I started to pray, Lord, send this man to Copenhagen that he might speak to our youth here. He says, I had no idea you'd come so quickly. And he says, then you're calling me from my own home. And so he said, you know, I'll stay there. When I get home, you can have lunch with us and have dinner with us. And so he came home. They ate lunch. Later on, they ate supper. And then he says, I insist you cancel your reservations wherever you're staying. I want you to stay in. I'm going to put you up in a hotel. And the guy's like, okay. And he says, well, let me go with you so I can apologize for canceling the reservation. He's like, oh, that's fine. I can take care of it. So he went and found his bag, dusted it off. And then went to the hotel. Now, when they got to the hotel, it was a Christian man who owned the hotel, and he says, we're completely full except for one giant family suite, but I'll give that to you. I'll only charge you the regular rate. And so the man paid the rate. He went up there. Now, he'd been praying for a bed because he hasn't slept in a bed for several weeks now. And he'd been praying for a bed, and when he opens the door, there were 5 beds. And so he said, I slept in all of them. Wanted to see which one was the most comfortable. Confused the nursemaid when she came in later. But Simon seems to be given this heads up to go. The Lord's calling him to go up to the temple. He starts to head there for this appointment. In verse 28, it says, he took him up in his arms and blessed God. and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all peoples, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. Notice this language. He's saying, now I can die. This kind of clues us in that he's an older man, because I don't think young men are like, okay, now I can die. You know, he's an older man. And he's been waiting for this. He's probably very old. He probably feels like he's ready to die. But he feels as though he now has accomplished what the Lord has called him to in his life. And I wonder when I hear that, have I accomplished what I feel like the Lord has wanted to do in my life? Am I in that mindset, okay, Lord, I've done what you asked me to do. Now I'm ready to go home and be with you. You know, I think that that's a question we should all ask ourselves. You know, not that it would necessarily be something radically different than we're already doing. You know, maybe the Lord has you where you're at in whatever job you're doing, and he has you there because God has everybody in places, in workforces, in different places, in different industries, so that we can be a light and a witness in those places and industries. But perhaps the Lord has something different for you to do. You know, I never thought I would be doing this, for sure. But I wonder if we would offer that to the Lord and say, Lord, what is it that you want me to do with my life? Is this what you want me doing? Or do you want to do something radically different with my life? Lord, show me where you want me to be. Show me where you want me to go. Show me how I could be used. And I think a lot of us would be surprised at the way that the Lord would use us. You know, I do talk to a lot of people, and I think one of the number one questions that people ask a pastor, especially young people, is how do I know what God's will is for my life? You know, and I think when it comes to that, the reality is like St. Augustine told a group of students, they asked him the same question, and he said, delight yourself in the Lord and then do whatever you want. Because the Bible says that he who delights himself in the Lord gives him the desires of his heart. The Lord starts to put in your heart the desires of the things he wants you to do and the way he wants you to be used. But I think it would do us well to say, Lord, what is it that I was created for? Why am I here? How do you want to use my life? What's the purpose of a man's life? He says here, my eyes have seen your salvation. Whose salvation? God's salvation. In fact, that's what Jesus' name means. God is salvation. And so he's saying, I've seen your salvation. And when we see God's salvation, when we see Jesus for the first time, it changes us, doesn't it? It changes us. And this is important. You've prepared the salvation before the face of all peoples. Remember, Abraham's promise in Genesis chapter 12:3 was that through him, all the nations of the earth will be blessed, that through his offspring, through his seed, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. And he's saying, I've seen that this is going to be something that's not just for us, not just for the Jews, but for all nations. It'll be a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles. This is amazing to me because here Simeon is saying this about Jesus, and yet the church would start, Acts chapter 2, and all these people from all over, Jews and proselytes, would become Christians. And for 12 years, the church would go on, and they would have no idea that God was going to bring light to the Gentiles. They thought, you know, Jesus has come to save the whole world, everywhere in the world where there's a Jew. Or anywhere the Jews would come become, or anywhere the Gentiles would become Jews through being a proselyte. And yet it was revealed to them as Peter would go down to Cornelius' house and he would see the Holy Spirit pour out on these men who had never been circumcised, never obeyed the law of God, and the Holy Spirit would pour out on them, and by faith they would receive the promise of God and salvation. And Peter would later testify in Acts chapter 15, I believe that we are saved the same way that the Gentiles are through faith in Jesus Christ alone and not by obedience to the law. Amazing. That would be the way that God would use Jesus. And this is prophesied at his dedication, at his presentation. It says, verse 33, and Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. Yeah, I bet they did. And then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is destined for fall and rising of many in Israel and for a sign which will be spoken against. You know, this is what's going to happen. Jesus is going to be one who would bring many to salvation, the rise of many. He's going to be a stepping stone to many who believe in his name, but he's also going to be a stumbling stone to those who won't believe. And there's going to be those who rise and those who fall. And it's amazing the way that the gospel has changed the world. And yet you see that, you know, you see that throughout life and throughout cultures and throughout our own experience, that Jesus, when he comes into somebody's life, he changes them. Irrevocably changes them. He transforms somebody who was a drug addict or a base person or a prostitute into something completely different. I know he did in my life, and I'm sure he did in most of our lives in this room. You know, that was one thing that really stood out to me. Henry Ironside, who was the pastor at Moody Bible Church, was walking down the street one day, and he saw he heard a band playing, and he saw a group of people, and he thought, the Salvation Army. He used to be a part of the Salvation Army. And so he went up, and he joined the crowd and started singing a chorus, and the commander there saw that it was Mr. Ironside, and she said, Henry, will you share your testimony? Will you preach? Now, Henry was accustomed to preaching. He could do it on the fly. He preached about 600 times a year, according to his biography. He'd find a street corner, and he'd just start preaching. And so he got up, and he started to preach. And then there was a man standing outside the crowd, and he walked forward. He wrote something on a card, and he handed it to Mr. Ironside. Well, he noticed that immediately. This is a man who was part of the trade unions and stuff. He was a big name, you know, caused a lot of stirring and stuff right there around World War I. And Henry looked at the back of the card, and on the back of the card it says, I challenge you, sir, to a debate of agnosticism versus Christianity. And Henry Ironside says, oh, I see I've been challenged to a debate. And he said, sir, I will accept your challenge on one condition, that you bring a man who was a sinner. He says, it doesn't matter what kind, whether he was a drunkard or a vagabond or a worthless individual, but because he heard of the virtues of agnosticism, he turned from that and became a better person. And a woman who was set free from prostitution and from drink and from all these other things. And because she heard of agnosticism and the gospel isn't true, that she became a better and more valuable member of society. And he says, I will bring no less than 100 men and women who have turned from drink, from turned from all kinds of base living. And because of the gospel of Jesus Christ, they've been transformed into a new creation. And the guy just waved him off and walked away. Silence is God. There is no other ideology in the world that changes and transforms lives like the gospel of Jesus Christ. And many will fall, but many will rise because of Jesus. He's the way, truth, and life, and no one comes to the Father except through him. But then he says to Mary something chilling. Notice verse 35, I guess it is. Yes, a sword will pierce through your own soul also, and the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. This is where it gets a little spooky. He speaks prophetically of Mary, how she's going to have her own heart broken. And no doubt this is something that she kind of deals with throughout her life. After Jesus starts his public ministry, she, in a sense, she goes to him and she says, Jesus, they've run out of wine. And he's like, what do you have to do with me, woman? I don't think it was disrespectful, but he's like, my time has not yet come. And yet he turns the water into wine. It's almost as though she's like, vindicate me now. I've been known as this adulteress for all these years, this woman who had a child out of wedlock. Vindicate me. You know, do what you need to do. And then when Jesus was preaching one time, her and her sons came to rescue Jesus. And of course, Jesus, in a sense, disowned them. They said, your mother and your brothers are out here seeking you. And he says, who is my mother and who is my brother? He says, those who do the will of my father, my mother, my sisters, and my brothers. And so Mary would wait, and then she would be there at the scene in John chapter 19 where Jesus is being crucified, and there was Mary watching her son die. She had to be so confused. And yet I wonder if she thought back to this prophecy over her that your own heart will be pierced by a sword, or pierced through your soul, rather. Verse 36, it says, now there was one Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age, and she lived with a husband 7 years from her virginity. And this woman was a widow of about 84 years, who did not depart from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. So here's a very pious woman. She's lived at the temple for 84 years since her husband passed away. She'd only been married for 7 years. Even if she got married as a teenager, she's over 100 years old. This is a very, very old woman. We're talking, Simeon was old, this woman's ancient. And she comes up, she's been there in the temple, serving the Lord, praying, she's a prophetess, she's super old, verse 38, and coming in that instant, she gave thanks to the Lord and spoke of him to all those who looked for the redemption in Jerusalem. So it just happened, she comes in while Simeon is speaking these words over Jesus, and she just starts to rejoice. She starts to praise the Lord. She knows Simeon. She knows how just and devout he is. She knows this guy is prophesying. And you know, the spirit of the prophet, you know, she has that same gift in her. She testifies to the truthfulness of it and begins to praise the Lord and spread it far and wide, tells everybody about it. You know, I love this. You know, here's an old woman who's lived out her entire life, no doubt, you know, wondering herself, when's the Messiah going to come here? Probably feeling the same way Simeon. I mean, at 100 and whatever she was, probably thinking, okay, now I can die too. You know, we can all die and things can go on. So when they had performed all these things according to the law, they brought the baby, presented him before the Lord, offered their offerings. They returned to Galilee to their own city, Nazareth. Now, they did eventually return to Nazareth. Of course, when somebody's writing, sometimes they leave out, you know, details, you know, depending on what the story is. They would leave Bethlehem, go to Nazareth. But first, as you know from Matthew, that the wise men would come. Now, I was trying to figure this out. You know, you probably heard Jesus was about 2 years old when the wise men came. Or maybe you just thought, you know, I just ruined Christmas because you thought it was at his birth in the manger. No, the wise men came later. But looking at the timeline, you know, if you get like one of the histories of the world, Usher's Annals of the World or something like that, you kind of find out, okay, Jesus was born right around probably the last year of Herod's life, maybe the beginning of the last year of Herod's life. And so Jesus was born, some months went by, the wise men came, spoke to Herod, he sent them to Bethlehem, because the child was supposed to be born in Bethlehem. They see the child in the house, so they're probably staying with family or something at that time, or they've rented a house or whatever, and they find the child in the house with his mother, and they offer the gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Now, we always think there's three wise men, right? Three wise guys from the east side, right? Now, there was three gifts. It never tells us how many wise men there were. You know, this is obviously an entourage of people because Herod's upset. The whole town of Jerusalem is upset when these guys come in. They send him down, and then they're warned in a vision not to go back to Herod and tell him where the child is because, you know, it's dangerous. And so they leave, and then Mary and Joseph are warned by an angel, leave and go down to Egypt. And so they go down to Egypt, and then Herod, probably just trying to erase any margin of error, has every male child under two, slaughtered. So they're in Egypt for a couple of months at least, maybe even up to a year until Herod is dead, which he died about a year after that. And so, you know, one of those things. But Luke doesn't record those details. There's a lot of details left out in all the Gospels. You know, of course, John said that if we wrote everything that Jesus said and did, I suppose the world could be able to be big enough to contain all the books that would be written. And so, you know, of course, Luke, for his purposes, he just and probably because of legal purposes. Some people believe that Luke was written actually as a legal defense for Paul's ministry. And if that's the case, that's probably why he left that part out. But they returned eventually to Galilee. And then it says, verse 40, and the child grew and became strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. And so here Jesus, he grows up. That's kind of hard to imagine, isn't it? I mean, you think of Jesus and you just imagine that he just came out of the womb, you know, like no problem and never cried and was always, you know, just an easy child, you know, he didn't have to grow up. He just started speaking fluently when he, you know, popped out of the womb or something. But no, it would indicate here that he grew. He grew and he became strong in spirit. You know, it's almost as though God allowed Jesus to suspend any previous knowledge. I don't know. I mean, we just don't know. The grace of God was upon him. He was filled with wisdom. And you get this idea that Jesus grew into something. Now, of course, he never sinned. He was perfect from the time he was born, and he never committed any sin. But what was he like as a child? It's hard to even wrap your mind around. And yet he became like us. And that's what's really mind-boggling, that Jesus would become like you. And in fact, Jesus would become so much like us that he would depend completely on the Father. The Bible tells us that he was filled with the Holy Spirit. All those things happened for Jesus in his life, because he was an example to us that we might follow in his steps, that we might walk in his steps, as Peter tells us. Well, what does that mean? It means that we need to be completely dependent upon the Father. It means that we need to grow in the grace and knowledge of God and in wisdom and in knowledge. And that's what Jesus has done for us, is he's shown us an example to follow. Now, of course, he didn't have sin, and so we have that, you know, that problem. But he paid for all of our sin so that we could be reconciled to God. So it's beautiful. We see this story of Jesus. We see these characters play out, you know, coming to the temple, being filled with the Holy Spirit. That's what God desires for us too, that we'd be filled with the Holy Spirit, that we'd be led by the Spirit, that we'd walk in the Spirit, and we'd be useful to his kingdom. Amen? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. We're grateful for this interesting story, Lord, about Simeon and Anna and just the things that you spoke through them, Lord, and did through them. And I pray, Jesus, that you would just help us, Lord, also to be just filled with your Spirit, Lord, like they were. That you would use us, Lord. That we, like Simeon, would be looking for your coming, Lord. That we would not lose heart, but that we would be anxiously awaiting your arrival, Lord. That we live our lives in such a way, Lord, that we would bring honor and glory to you, and we would not be ashamed at your coming. It's in Jesus' name we pray.